I want to ask you to grab a Bible and turn to the New Testament, to the book of Acts, chapter 7. And we're going to begin in verse 22 and following in just a little bit. Heard about two little boys who were sharing a hospital room with each other, and one little boy turns to the other one. He said, "What are you in here for?" He said, "I'm here to get my tonsils out." The other kid said, "Oh, you don't need to worry about that." He said, "I had my tonsils out a few years ago." He said, "They put you under, you go to sleep, you get all the jello and ice cream you want afterwards." He said, "It was a piece of cake." He said, "What are you in here for?" He said, "For circumcision." He said, "Whoa." He said, "I had that done when I was born." He goes, "I couldn't walk for a year." Well, today we're going to talk about wounds. But we're not talking about the kinds of wounds to your body. We're talking about wounds to your soul. You say, "Well, Gene, what do you mean wounds to your soul?" Let me give you a definition of a wound. A wound is a deep sense that there is a core part of us that is unloved, unaccepted, and unwanted. There is a core part of us that is unloved, unaccepted, and unwanted. A wound is an injury to the core part of us that sometimes forever affects us. In some of us, this wound is a gaping gash. In others, it's just a neck. For some, it's a bruise. But we all get them. And I want to get started today by studying Moses to discover the truth about our wounds, because there are basically three different eras of woundedness. And if you live long enough, if you live in the same world that I do, you're going to discover that, number one, wounds get inflicted. They do. We just saw this footage of Moses' mother, you know, hiding him in the basket so Pharaoh's daughter would find him and raise him as the prince of Egypt. But I want to ask you today to take Moses out of the realm of superhero. I want you to take him out of the realm of phenomenal leader for a moment. And I want to make him a case study in child development. Remember that as a child, Moses didn't know that God was going to use him to be the deliverer of the people. Moses hadn't read the book of Exodus yet. And so let's imagine that Moses is standing up here this morning as a woundedness support group member. Maybe he's a member of Celebrate Recovery or something. And I was kind of speculating what he might say, and I think this might be a story. I think he might say, "Hi, I'm Moses. I heard you guys were doing a series on me, so I wanted to share my story with you. Here's how it started. I was born into a very hostile environment, kind of a basket case from the beginning. I was born at a time and place where my life and the lives of every little Hebrew boy were in constant jeopardy. There was this really evil, insecure king who was threatened by the growing number of us, and so he ordered every newborn boy killed. So when I was 3 months old, I got abandoned. My mom, out of good intention, thought the best thing she could do for me was abandon me. She put me in a little makeshift basket among the reeds of a riverbank. Now the good news is I didn't die there, but a very strange thing happened. A princess, a very successful, powerful, significant person, picked me up. She had compassion on me and adopted me into her home. And the story gets even wilder because she knew I needed to be nursed. And so she summons my sister, who just happened to be standing close by, to go find a Hebrew woman who could nurse me. Guess who she found? Yeah, my mom. Looking back, I can see the hand of God in all of this now, but at the time, it was just flat out confusing. The princess, Pharaoh's daughter, who adopted me, was not one of my people. She was ethnically, racially, and religiously different from me. So I spent the first 40 years of my life never really belonging with the people who raised me. I was different from them. I didn't fit. I wasn't like the other kids. I was part royalty, part slave. And it wasn't easy. For the first 40 years of my life, a very core part of my soul felt unaccepted, unloved, and unwanted. I just wanted to belong, but I never felt like I fit in. I guess I got a little dinged, a little wounded along the way, and I ended up dealing with all kinds of anger issues and insecurity issues the rest of my life. I'm Moses. Thank you for listening to my story. Show of hands, how many of you have ever seen the California redwoods? Anybody? Yeah, a number of you have. This one right here, this is trees known as General Sherman. It's the largest known tree in the world. 19 people standing around it here. It's between 2,300 and 2,700 years old. Just magnificent. On the outside, it looks so strong and sturdy, like nothing's wrong. But if you could cut that tree open and look at the rings inside that tree, every ring of every year would tell you a story. For instance, it might tell you a story about a year of drought. And then you might find a year of great rain and growth. And then you might find a year where the tree was hit by lightning. And you might find another year where a tree was hit by one of my golf balls. Every ring would tell you a story. And it got me to thinking that, you know, we look so sturdy on the outside, but what if you could cut us open? What would the rings inside of our lives tell about our story? Maybe there's a ring that shows the time an alcoholic father wounded you, wounded your soul with hateful words, angry words, or went after your mom with a butcher knife. Maybe there's the ring where you brought home a report card that showed significant improvement only to have it be compared to your sister who got straight A's. Maybe there's the ring where you first discovered that you were adopted, and as loved as you were in the home that you grew up in, you wondered why someone else didn't want you. Maybe there's a ring that shows a spouse closing the door for the last time after 12 years of marriage, and it's just over. Maybe there's the ring of the absence of never hearing the words come out of the mouth of your dad or the mouth of your mom, "I love you." Maybe there's the ring where you were touched by someone in completely inappropriate ways that they had no right to touch you. Maybe there's a ring that shows you were never allowed to cry. Maybe there's one that made you feel accepted only if you could catch the ball or run faster or jump higher or score the points. Maybe there's the ring where you came across a spouse's email or text messages or phone records where you first began to think, there's another woman, there's another man. How about it? Got any rings with some wounds on them? Is there a part of you with a little nick or a bruise or a wound or a gash that has never felt loved, accepted, or wanted? Wounds get inflicted on all of us. Now, like most nicked and wounded and bruised people, Moses compensated for the wound, and he did it in multiple ways. Our text tells this story in Acts chapter 7. Which says in verse 22 that Moses was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and he was powerful in speech and in action. Now let's think about this. He was very educated. He went to all the right schools. He got all the right degrees behind his name. It says that he was powerful in speech. He knew how to turn a phrase. He knew how to motivate a crowd. It says he was powerful in action. He was a guy who could get things done. Hebrews chapter 11 says that he was also beautiful. He was physically attractive. And sometimes that complicates life for a wounded person because on the outside they look like everything is together and nobody can see the woundedness on the inside of them. Now here's the point. For the first 40 years of Moses' life, for 40 years, he's wounded. But he compensates for it with education and with achievement and with powerful speech and with leadership abilities and with Brad Pitt good looks. We would look at him and he'd say, wow, look at this guy. He's really overcome his past, hasn't he? But the truth is, deep down, he just wanted to belong. And he knew his DNA didn't fit with the Egyptians. And it troubled him. Notice the next verse, verse 23. Begins with the words, when Moses was 40 years old. Just pause there. Isn't that interesting? When he was 40 years old. Something just seems to happen to people when they get to be around 40 years old, give or take a few years. It's like they've been trying to hold this beach ball under the water all of their lives, and they finally just get tired of holding it under the water, and they just say, I think I'll let it come up and see what happens. Verse 23, when Moses was 40 years old, he decided to visit his fellow Israelites. Now, what is he doing there? He hits 40, and he decides maybe it's time to reconnect with that unconnected part of myself, with my own people, with my own flesh and blood. Tired of feeling unaccepted and unwanted and unloved among the Egyptians, he decides to reconcile himself with the Hebrew culture, to move back into community with the Israelites. He wanted to find acceptance. I heard about a tourist from Barstow that was in New York City one time and walked into a big fancy restaurant, tried to get a table, and the maitre d' said, "I'm sorry, sir, you're going to need a tie in order to eat here." So he went out to his pickup truck and he got a pair of jumper cables and he tied them around his neck and he walked into the restaurant. And the maitre d' said, "Well, I guess that'll do." He said, "But don't you go starting anything." Moses tries to fit in, and he ends up starting something. Look at verse 24. He saw one of them, one of the Israelites, being mistreated by an Egyptian. And so he went to his defense, and he avenged him by killing the Egyptian. Now, why did Moses do this? Look at the next statement. Moses thought that his own people would realize that God was using him to rescue them, but they did not. Moses supposed that his own people would want him. He supposed that this would be the healing for his wound. He tries so hard to fit in with the Israelites, and he attempts to prove his sincerity by murdering an Egyptian who was mistreating one of his own people. And he was trying to say, "I'm on your side, gang. I hate this kind of injustice." But nobody was impressed. So think about it now. Here's this 40-year-old wounded guy in midlife crisis. He's making his first attempt to find healing for his soul by reconnecting with his people. And instead, the wound just gets inflicted deeper. And so the Bible says, jump to verse 29. Moses fled to Midian, where he settled as a foreigner. Now, many people think that Moses fled to Midian because he was a murderer. I don't think that. I think he ran because he now felt like, "I don't belong anywhere. I don't belong in either place. I don't belong with the Egyptians. I don't belong with the Israelites." And notice it says he settled as a foreigner. What does that mean? I'm an outsider. I don't belong. I don't fit anywhere. And so this first era in a season of woundedness is wounds get inflicted. And sometimes they get inflicted even deeper as time goes by. And this brings us to the second era, which some of us are specialists in. Wounds get camouflaged. Moses spent the next 40 years of his life in the desert. And 2 weeks from now, we're going to look at seasons in the desert in our life and navigating those times. And during that time, Moses was in the desert. He has this dramatic encounter with God, and he ends up going back to Egypt and becoming the deliverer of these people who had rejected him. The wounded person, 40 years later, at the age of 80, becomes the success. And Moses learns to camouflage his wounds with achievement. Dr. Stephen Berglas is an executive coach, and he's a management consultant. He spent 25 years as a clinical psychologist on the faculty of Harvard Medical School, and he wrote a book entitled The Success Syndrome. And in it, he talks about successful people. He talks about Moses-like people, people like many of you. And listen to what he says about people like Moses. He says, quote, "They carry an opened wound that they're really running to escape from. What I think is significant is how these people find that success does nothing to assuage, to heal that injury. At a certain level, success exasperates it, making the person more alone. They strive and strive to get more and more, and they wonder, how could we ever know if we are loved independent of success? If everything was gone, would anybody love me?" See, the drivenness behind many successful people is just their attempt to mask a wound that's a deep part of their soul, a part of them that is unlovable, unwanted, and unaccepted. A very famous Olympic athlete who is well known all over the country for not only his great athletic ability and for winning the gold, but for his good looks and his charm, went through a very public divorce. And when the press talked to his ex-wife, they said, "This must be very hard for you to be rejected by this world-class athlete, you know, this famous celebrity. It must be tearing you up." And she said, "No." She said, "You don't understand. Those of you in the press just see what my husband is running toward, the goals, the medal, the finish line." She said, "But I live with him every day, and I see what he's running from." Moses camouflaged his wounds with success. Remember what Stephen Berglas said? He says, success does not heal the wound. It exasperates it because it focuses the question, am I loved apart from what I do? Successful people, they're never quite sure. And so they refuse to do the Wizard of Oz thing and pull back the curtain and say, you know, this is who I really am back here. It's just me. Well, friends, the final 40 years of Moses' life drove the wound even deeper, because if wounds aren't treated and if wounds get camouflaged, eventually infection seeps out. Wounded people tend to lash out in their frustration, and the poison inside of them seeps out into the lives of those around them, and it begins to destroy relationships. And so this wounded leader, Moses, during this journey of leading the people out of Egypt and toward the promised land, began to hear some things that he never wanted to hear. On at least 8 different occasions, the people rebel against Moses. And I think every act of rebellion was like a knife in an open wound in Moses. I think every time the people complained, every time they griped, Moses was hearing over and over again, Moses, we don't love you just for who you are. You don't fit here. You're not one of us. In fact, we resent you for bringing us out here. Some deliverer you are. We were better off back in Egypt. And I think one of the most difficult things for Moses was he began to hear those same kind of words from his brother and his sister, Aaron and Miriam. And they began to talk against him. And that had to be hurtful, because the thing that hurts for most wounded people is when those closest to you, those who should understand, those who should be tender and gentle and caring with you, reject you. There are some people who you just think, oh, I should always be able to count on them. I should always be able to count on my mom. I should always be able to count on dad, my brother, my sister, or this friend. I mean, we're closer than any family. Should have always been able to count on them. Well, finally, Moses couldn't take it anymore. And the infection seeps out. And fast forward to the 8th time that the people rebel against Moses. They're thirsty again. God has miraculously quenched their thirst before. And so Moses comes to God and he says, God, what do I do? And God says, go speak to the rock and I'll pour water out from it. And so many of you remember the story how Moses goes to the rock and he has a staff with him. And the Bible says in Numbers chapter 20, it records this scene. It says, then Moses raised his arm and he struck the rock twice with his staff. Just bam, bam, he struck it. He didn't speak to the rock as God said. He struck it. The Bible says water gushed out and the community and their livestock drank. That's all good. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, because you did not trust in me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the Israelites, you will not bring this community into the land, into the promised land I give them. All the people are excited because now they've got water to drink. God pulls Moses off to the side and says, because you didn't honor me, because you didn't obey me, because you struck the rock instead of speaking to it, you can't go into the promised land. So Moses didn't get to go into the promised land because he hit the rock. Now, question, important question. Why did he hit the rock? Why? Did he forget what God had said? Did he get a little confused? Do you know why I think Moses hit the rock? My speculation. I think Moses had had enough rejection throughout his life and he just couldn't take it anymore. And the infection of that wound just seeped out. I think Moses hit the rock because from the time he was a little boy, he had been wounded when his mother abandoned him. And so when he's 40, he tries to reach out to his own people who reject him. And then he has to become a foreigner in another land for the next 40 years. And then God found him, and Moses accepted the call, believing, now, finally, people will accept me, and I will become their deliverer. But after 40 years of leading those people, all they did was keep their distance from him, and they forced him to camouflage his wounds. And when they didn't get what they wanted, they complained, they griped, they rebelled, they whined, and they ripped on Moses. And finally, the people rebel against him this one last time, along with his brother and his sister. And in so doing, they scream at him, Moses, you just don't get it, do you? You're not wanted here. And I think he couldn't take the pain anymore, and the infection just seeped out. And in striking the rock, I think he was saying, I've had it with you people. All I ever wanted was to be loved by you. And you keep telling me, I don't belong. Well, the heck with it. The heck with you. Here's your water, you bunch of rebels. I just can't take the pain anymore. And Moses hit the rock. Friends, the truth of the matter is, unless we find healing for our wounds, we're going to hit the rock too. You can only camouflage your wounds for so long. Some of you are going to hit the rock, and for you, the rock is not anger, it's power. You try to control everything with power in your life until one day you're going to hit your 17-year-old, the one thing in your life that you find out you can't control with power. For some of you, the rock you're going to hit is lust. And you've kept it contained for a long time. You battle it. And it's that balloon you hold under the water, and it's going to pop up. And you're going to destroy a relationship. You're going to destroy a marriage. You're going to destroy a family. You're going to destroy your kids. You're going to destroy your reputation. You're going to destroy your career over it. Maybe for you, it's greed. It's not power or anger or lust. It's greed. And you're going to grab one thing too many one day. You're going to go for the deal you knew you should have walked by, and that deal is going to take you down. You see, if you don't pay attention to your wounds, to your nicks, and to your bruises, eventually the infection seeps out, and they get revenge. So I want to talk with the remaining minutes that we have to those of you who recognize you got some wounds inside and you want to find the path to healing. And I want to mention three of the things that I know are incumbent for healing to take place. And this is not like a 1-2-3 step formula that's like a real simple little formula. These are like just things that I know are incumbent on every journey of healing. For instance, I know number one, you got to tell the truth to yourself and to God about this stuff. If you're sitting here today during this time and God has exposed some rings in your life and some woundedness, and if you're saying, I'm the one with the nick, the bruise, the wound, the gash, and I haven't paid attention to it, and I'm afraid that infection is going to seep out one day, and I don't want to hit the rock, then you got to start being honest with yourself and honest with God about that. President James Garfield was one of a handful of presidents in the U.S. who've been shot while in office. But you know, the thing that killed him was not the bullet. The thing that killed him was because of the constant probing trying to find the bullet, infection set in, and that's what killed him. And if we don't locate the wound and deal with it honestly ourselves and with God about our wounds, that infection will kill our souls. The psalmist expresses this to God in Psalm 51:6. He says, but you desire honesty from the heart so that you can teach me to be wise in my inmost being. Honesty from the heart. A healthy inner being requires an honest heart. You know the old saying, the revealing of feelings is the beginning of healing. Revealing your feelings is the beginning of healing. Moses didn't deal honestly with his wounds, and he didn't get the healing that's available to us, and he failed to reach the promised land because of it. Friends, some people have found it really helps to get at the root of this stuff by unpacking it with a trusted, wise friend or unpacking it with a Christian counselor of some kind, and if you need to find a good counselor, our team can help you. We've got some good referrals that we can do on this. Lots of us in this church have benefited from counseling. I've benefited from counseling in my life through a couple of different eras of my life. I'm not embarrassed or ashamed to admit that. Well, one of the most courageous things that some of you can do in your life, some of you guys in this room, would be to man up and to walk into a counselor's office to start unpacking some of this stuff so that you don't seep out and damage those that you love the most. Being honest with yourself, revealing your feelings, is the beginning of healing. Second, if you want to experience a season of healing, you're going to have to be receptive to God's activity in your life. Friends, wounds can be one of the greatest catalysts for experiencing the touch and the love and the grace and the working of God in our lives. In that movie, The Prince of Egypt, Moses' father-in-law sings a song that's called Through Heaven's Eyes. It's a powerful song. And listen to these lyrics. He says, quote, "So how can you see what your life is worth or where your value lies? You can never see through the eyes of man. You must look at your life, look at your life, look at your life through heaven's eyes." The Apostle Paul makes a very interesting statement in 2 Corinthians 7. He says, "Now I am glad, not because it hurt you, but because the pain turned you toward God." See, pain is what often breaks through the wall of our denial that we don't need God, and it helps us recognize we need God. We need the love of God. And some of you would say, yeah, it was exactly the pain in my life. It was the wounds that helped me open up to my need for God. You say, oh yeah, I can still feel the emptiness of the house when she slammed the door and said, I'm never coming back. But it opened me up to God's activity for the first time in my life. Or you would say, I remember one weekend sitting in church after the most painful wound in my life, and I cried all the way through the service, and it was as if almost God was whispering to me, hey, your life may not be working right now, but I can help you if you will let me in. Friends, that's the kind of stuff that can be a signal to say, hey, it's time. It's time to be receptive to the activity of God in my life. It's time to acknowledge that I matter to God. It's time to look at my life, look at my life, look at my life through God's eyes, through heaven's eyes, the eyes of hope, the God who accepts me instead of trying to be something I'm not. Tell the truth to yourself and to God. Be receptive to God's activity in your life. And finally, become a wounded healer. You know, the most compassionate people I know, the people who bring the most healing to the lives of others, are those who've been wounded themselves. God used Moses, this wounded man, in incredible ways, and he will use you too. God never wastes a hurt. And you see, God can not only heal our wounds, but he can recycle our pain to help us bring healing to others who are going through the same thing that we've gone through. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 1, it says, why does God do this? So that when others are troubled, needing our sympathy and encouragement, we can pass on to them this same help and comfort God has given us. So when you've experienced some kind of wound in your life, you are so effective in extending the help and comfort to others that you've received from God. One of the things I love about Eastside is that this is a church full of wounded healers. We've got people who know the wound of divorce, and they come alongside and offer compassion to those who are going through divorce. We've got people who've been wounded by burying loved ones, and they come alongside and offer love and support to those who've buried loved ones. We've got those wounded by their childhood, and they're extending compassion and love to others who are unpacking and dealing with wounds from their childhood. We've got those wounded by living with addicts, and they're extending compassion to others who live with addicts. We've got those who are dealing with their substance abuses and their alcoholism, and they are extending compassion and hope and recovery to others who are dealing with substance abuse and alcoholism. Friends, that's how the family of God is supposed to work. And it breaks my heart that Moses never had that. It breaks my heart that those who could have helped heal that pain, that wound in him, instead just drove the wound deeper. And instead of entering the promised land, this wounded prince of Egypt hit the rock. It didn't have to be that way. And your life doesn't have to be that way. The God of the universe has compassion for your wounds, and it wasn't a baby in a basket. He sent a baby in a manger who would die on a cross for our transgressions, and by his stripes we would be healed.